Hello and welcome to Wilson Center Now, a production of the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars. I'm John Molesky. I'm joined today by my colleague, Alex Long, who will serve as a co-host for today's discussion. Alex is a program associate with the Wilson Center's Science and Technology Innovation Program. We'll hear from him in just a second. As for our guest today, it's difficult to imagine someone with a more experience or expertise that matches the subject matter than Dr. Richard Besser. He is president and CEO of the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, and he's a former acting director of the CDC and a former medical correspondent for ABC News. Dr. Besser, Alex, welcome. Thank you for joining us.
Really nice to be here. Thank you.
Thanks for having me, John.
Hope you're both doing well under the circumstances and hunkering down with your families, Riding this out together. Let me begin, Dr. Besser. I mentioned in the introduction some of the amazing experience that you have that really prepares you for this moment in history. You're at the CDC, running the CDC during H1N1, covering on the ground Ebola for ABC News. If past is prelude to where we are today, what do you think when you hear people talking about the pandemic now and saying, who could have seen this coming?
You know, that's a phrase that with every public health emergency, with every crisis, is repeated over and over again. I took the job at CDC as head of emergency preparedness and response the day Katrina hit New Orleans. And I remember the after actions out of that disaster saying, no one could have foreseen this coming. Though if you go back, you'll see all kinds of reports that it was predictable. There was a leadership program I was in at Harvard, and one of the professors was a man named Max Bazerman, and he wrote a book called Predictable Surprises. And these moments in history, I think, fit really well with that label. There are things that were totally predictable that had been predicted, but when they occur, we act as if we're surprised. And when it comes to public health emergencies, it's a classic because, you know, during an emergency, there's all kinds of resources to respond. Immediately afterwards, there are resources to build infrastructure and prepare. But within a year of that period, the resources start to dry up and the level of preparedness goes down. No one likes to be on the edge of their seat any longer than they need to. And so even having conversations about disasters and what might come is really difficult to have in the political arena.
Is it a matter of complacency? Is it a matter of kicking the can down the road? Why aren't we better prepared for things that experts like you are telling us are likely to happen?
Well, I think it's all of those factors. If you look at the individual level, you know, the years that I ran emergency preparedness and response, I would go to conferences of people who worked in the field of emergency preparedness and response. And I would say to the conference, you know, how many of you have an emergency response plan for your family? And there would be just a few hands that go up. How many of you have an emergency response kit in your home to be able to take care of your family's needs for 72 hours? A smattering of hands would go up. And that's despite the fact that every state in America has had a declared natural disaster within the past 20 years, you know, mainly weather related, but something that reaches the level of requiring federal support and response. I went to, on this trip to Israel years ago when I was working in emergency preparedness and response, and there had a conversation with leaders about this very question, about the focus on response and preparedness, and because Israel is extremely prepared. But there, disasters and emergency, whether it's bombings or other kinds of emergencies, were a daily, a weekly occurrence. And so it was front of mind and people would prepare. Here, even in Tornado Alley, people tend not to be prepared for tornadoes.
I can only imagine how many of our viewers or those of us here, like myself, had twinges of guilt when you talked about lack of preparation just on the micro level. I don't have a first aid kit or the types of things that anyone responsibly should have in their home, so I understand completely what you're saying. So let me ask Alex about this whole notion of preparation or response, and then I want to come back to you, Dr. Besser, because Alex, you wrote this piece in the Washington Post where essentially you made the case that no matter what we do, we're damned if we do, damned if we don't. If we react in a way that creates a real flattening of the curve quickly, we're accused of overreacting if we get it right. Talk about that a little bit, Alex, then we'll come back to Dr. Besser for his thoughts.
Yeah, so I think I wrote that back on March 13th, and I was talking about how if everything goes right and we all do the social distancing to the degree that we should, all of these curves will be lower, they'll be flattened, and there will be less cases, there'll be less death. But the narrative that will definitely crop up is we overreacted, or this was actually all for naught. And at the time, I talked to a lot of people, and I was watching as the public health community via Twitter and then in articles was basically saying, that's okay if they think we overreacted. And I was trying to make the case that while it's not on the public health officials to convince us that they didn't overreact, it's on us, the public, to make sure that we're talking to each other about how we are seeing these curves flatten in some cases because of the good work that we've done. And we can't take our foot off the pedal, so to speak, just because it looks like it may have been an overreaction. And we're getting into that right now. I think that we're now seeing pundits talk about, it's not as bad as we thought it would. Why did we do all of this? And yeah.
Dr. Besser, what does that look like from the leadership position when you're sitting at the CDC, fully aware of the types of things that Alex just described? How do you calculate that when you're making decisions, or how do you work that into your calculations?
Well, it's something that you can predict will happen. I think Alex is right on the mark. You know, in 2009, when we were initially responding to H1N1, the swine flu pandemic, at the beginning, it's impossible to know how severe it is. You know, our plan, we've been doing a lot of planning for pandemic flu, and we had talked about scenarios, and the baseline scenario was a new strain of flu, bird flu, emerging off of the coast of Indonesia. And so we'd have a few weeks to prepare. Well, H1N1, when the pandemic hit, the first case was diagnosed in San Diego. So plans were out the window. We didn't have a three-week period. And what you want to do at the beginning of a new emerging infectious disease is you go out hard, you go out strong, and when you know that you can back off, then you do. And you expect that you're going to get some people who say you did too much. But you know, at the beginning, you don't know how bad it's going to be. Here with the coronavirus pandemic, it's a whole different ballgame in terms of severity. We dodged a bullet back in 2009. But here you're seeing again some of that the same narrative playing out. Some of the early predictions in terms of potential deaths in the U.S. were over 2 million. Now they're less than 100,000. Some of that is just the nature of models. When models start, they're using data that's not tends not to be that reliable. And then as you get better numbers, you build models that are much more in line with reality. But as well, if you do things right, you're going to have an impact on the final outcome. And some will say, you know, thank you so much for doing all you did to save lives. And others will say, you totally overreacted. It's inevitable you're going to get that response.
So 60,000 deaths only sounds good in comparison to 2.5 million deaths.
That's right.
By the way, right. And Alex, you have a question for Dr. Besser?
Yeah, I was actually wondering, hearkening back to your time during the H1N1 epidemic, I'm wondering how you feel about the CDC's current role in how they're not necessarily front and center in the White House press briefing room, and if you think what your take is on that.
Well, you know, when I think back to H1N1 and success factors, I think one of the critical success factors was trust. There was polling done by Harvard School of Public Health during that response, and what they were seeing were levels of trust by the public in government that were higher than they'd ever seen in a public health emergency. And that came from the transparency that we tried to provide through our communication. You know, every day briefing the public through the media, here's what we know, here's what we don't know, here's what we're doing to learn more, here's what you can do to protect your health. And getting in the rhythm of that conversation, it allowed us to make mistakes and explain them. We tried something we thought would work and it didn't. Here's what we learned from that. We could explain why things were happening at different paces in different places and the value in terms of learning from that. When you don't have CDC out front talking through that process, what they're doing to learn from what's happened in countries around the world and in different places in the US, then when you see it in news reports, it sounds like there's no coherence. And that makes it challenging. When everything you're hearing is coming from political leaders, it makes it much more challenging to understand, well, what's based on the best public health science and what's based on other policy considerations? Because clearly, science is only one factor that goes into decision-making, but you really want to know what that science is saying and recommending so you can interpret what you're being asked to do.
The national conversation tends to distill this conversation to major, giant, monolithic things like the economy. But in a piece that I saw that you wrote, and I know that the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation's interest in public health is ongoing and didn't just begin with the pandemic, you talk about things like school lunch programs and how many students were allowed. Could you talk about some of those ripple effects that maybe aren't front and center in the headlines that people should be thinking about?
Yeah, and we're starting to see a little bit more in the news. But you know, one thing that was clear from the beginning of this is that one's ability to do the things that were recommended by public health depended in a large part on your income and your wealth. You know, for many people, physical distancing, staying at home, is quite inconvenient, but it's doable. For other people, hourly workers, people who don't have sick leave, may not be eligible for unemployment insurance. For those folks, they're being asked to make a decision between going to work and putting food on the table and paying rent so they don't get evicted, or doing the things that they want to do as well to protect themselves, their families, and their communities. And what this is pointing to is policy failures that have occurred over decades and decades, and a society in which your ability to have health and well-being depends on a large part on your income, where you happen to live, and the color of your skin.
In this matrix that you describe, talk to us a bit about the role of NGOs like the organization that you represent and the private sector, because most of the attention goes, of course, to the top-down response, the authority bias, I think that's called. But talk to us about that larger community of organizations like yours that need to respond in times like this, or maybe more importantly, need to prepare us in advance for moments like this.
Well, you know, I think philanthropy has an important role, and we see an important role for the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. One of the things that we've done here, and it's really the first time in our history, is we've provided a significant amount of resources for direct humanitarian aid. So we announced $50 million that's going to provide support for food, for housing, income support, to groups who are some of the groups that are being hit the hardest who aren't part of the national conversation. So some of this work is going to domestic workers. When you think about domestic workers, well, when we talk about healthcare workers and the work that they're doing, we frequently forget all of the low-paid domestic workers who are providing care in people's homes for the elderly, providing care in nursing homes, providing care for people who have disabilities. But many of these people are going to work without personal protective equipment. They're not earning what they need to be able to decide for themselves whether they want to go to work or want to stay home. And if they're being let go, may not have access to any of the social safety net programs that are essential. So we're trying to call out issues of equity and fairness through the humanitarian assistance we're doing, while at the same time working on our main focus, which is really long-term policy change. You know, one of the things that struck me early on in this is the message from public health, and it was the right one, that we need to take pressure off the healthcare system. So if you were sick and you were mildly sick, you should call your doctor. You shouldn't go to the emergency room. Well, there are 28 million people in America without health insurance. So who do they call? A lot of the states that have put in testing to make testing available require a referral from your doctor. So lower income people without a doctor are having to go to the emergency room. And many of the places are doing drive-through testing. That's great if you have a car. If you don't have a car, if you're getting around on public transit, you're risking exposing other people, exposing yourself. So we need to be thinking about how do we ensure that everyone in America can do these things to protect their health. As a philanthropy, we're calling up these issues. We're working in Washington with our policy grantees to advocate for changes. And right now what we're seeing coming out of Washington are short-term fixes, which are meeting some of the needs, and more will need to be done. But what we'd like to see is longer-term fixes. So things like universal health care, national standards for sick leave and family leave, so that everyone has that opportunity to take care of their families. The moratorium that's in place right now on eviction and foreclosure and shutting off utilities. Wouldn't that be a wonderful thing if that was permanent, so that small changes in people's economic status wouldn't put them out on the streets? There's a lot of things with a pandemic where we have the opportunity to say, what kind of society do we want to have going forward, and what will it take to get us there?
I think that's a really good point. And when you bring up philanthropies and cooperation and disparities, I'd be remiss not to ask you to comment on where you think the WHO fits in this process, and how your work with them in your past career lends you to view the WHO and their very important place in the space.
Yeah, I've had the good fortune of working with folks from the World Health Organization all over the globe, as well as working in Geneva on different panels and consultations for the WHO. And the WHO is in a really challenging position. They are providing advice and counsel for every country on the planet. They're responsible for ensuring not just that resource-rich countries like the United States have what they need, but that lower-income countries have what they need. And they do this all with just the barest of resources. CDC has always had a very close role with the World Health Organization and sends a number of staff to work at the World Health Organization and cover those salaries. And the U.S. has always valued the role of the World Health Organization as this important body for getting the globe together around health issues. I'm an infectious disease epidemiologist, and one of the things that's said in the field is that an infectious threat anywhere is a threat everywhere. And if we're not working through global cooperation to try and help other countries identify and control diseases where they arise, then we are at more risk here within our own borders. Besides the fact that there's really a moral imperative as the wealthiest nation on earth to try and help other countries face this public health threat successfully. So, this is a time to rally around the World Health Organization, give them more support. Clearly, every country and every organization will do things that they wish they had done differently. But one of the things the World Health Organization always has to balance is, what will it take to get cooperation from nations? And there's a lot of diplomacy involved to get countries to share information, to share it readily, so that there could be a global effort to try and control and contain.
Speaking of information, I shared with a colleague of mine that you were going to be a guest on this edition of Wilson Center Now. And he said, well, great, I look forward to watching that one, because he's hungry for solid information and feeling as if he's struggling to find it. Where does somebody like you have intimate knowledge of sharing information from the government perspective, from network news perspective, now from your perch at the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, where do you look to for the best information?
I sent around a list to friends anyway on Facebook, but it is important to know that there is a ton of misinformation out there, and there's a lot of information around treatments and that are in many cases dangerous, but in other cases have nothing to back them up. There are a number of sites I go to. I go to the CDC website. It's trusted information. It's providing guidance on what you can do to protect your health. I look at the situation updates from World Health Organization. FEMA has a site that does rumor control. For case counts, I like the site at Johns Hopkins that's providing good information. It's really useful to have a link to your state health department, because that will give you what's being recommended in your area in terms of control. And one of the things we're going to find as this moves forward and states start to think about removing some of the measures around physical distancing, is that there will be different things done in different places depending on the degree of disease activity. So you really want to pay attention not just to the national picture or the global picture, but to the local picture. And your state will likely be providing guidance in terms of what's recommended there, especially as more testing is available and we're able to see at that level, at the state level, at the local level, how much disease transmission is going on and when it may make sense to start to lighten some of the measures of physical distancing.
I know it's difficult to say, but where are we on that timeline? What should people be expecting? Are we talking about social distancing for the next year? How long? I know that we won't continue a complete lockdown for a year, but some are saying that we will be still practicing certain elements of the lockdown into 2021 or 2022.
Yeah, I think it's hard to predict that far out for a number of reasons. One is that we don't yet have the type of testing to be able to see how much disease transmission has already occurred. So right now in most places we're at a level of limited clinical testing. So only people with pretty severe illness are being tested for COVID-19. You want to get to a point where even people with mild illness can be tested, or people who might have been exposed, or frontline workers who might not know, but you want to make sure they're not coming in and maybe without any symptoms spreading an illness. So we need to be in a situation where widespread clinical testing is available. And then the other type of testing that's in the news a fair bit right now is something called serology. And that's blood testing that can tell you whether or not someone has had this infection in the past. And given that some data show that quite a number of people who get this infection may never know it, have no symptoms whatsoever, it will be really useful to know how much population immunity there is. Because eventually, what you want to see is the population immunity rise, either through vaccine or because people have gotten sick. And that can tell you how much risk still exists in the community and when it's safe to remove social distancing. But I think the reports that are out that are saying that we can expect to see some changes in behavior that go on for more than a year, that's realistic to think about. The idea that you might go into a restaurant and there are fewer tables, or that in certain public settings you might be encouraged to wear a mask, or encouraged to continue to do very frequent hand washing. Or that businesses or schools may do staggered kind of shifts. So, at this point, it's too hard to say, but it is, I think, very valuable to foreshadow that so that people can expect that it's not going to be back to how it was in December from how it is right now, that there will be probably a staged removal of some of the measures that are currently in place.
All of these changes to daily life, I'd be interested to hear your perspective on how successful you think the ideas being floated by Google and Apple using US citizens' phones to do some sort of tracking, like how you think that would actually play out in the current United States.
Yeah, I think there's a dialogue going on around that and concerns about the value of technology to be able to do some kinds of tracking and tracing, but then concerns in terms of privacy and being able to monitor where people go. The other point I want to make, though, about testing and contact tracing and reopening is that it's clear that this pandemic is not hitting everyone equally. Black Americans are being infected at higher rates and are dying at higher rates. Some of that it has to do with risk factors from entrenched structural racism. Some has to do with who's getting tested and why. And some has to do with being in jobs that are considered essential services, whether it's food service, frontline healthcare workers, people who are involved in transit. And so as this goes forward, we want to make sure that we are getting data that's not just looking at a locality, but is broken down to the community, to the neighborhood level, and by race, so that we're able to ensure that if there are subpopulations within a community where this is being hit hardest, that we're not just accepting that, but we're saying, okay, why? Let's study that. Let's understand that. Let's put in the control measures so that everyone is protected here. And currently, we're seeing some stories on that, but we're not seeing the comprehensive collection of data. And thinking about ways technology can help with that to be able to pinpoint areas that are at increased risk. You know, the CDC has something called the Social Vulnerability Index that ranks every community in America based on a number of factors, including things like poverty rates, unemployment rates, level of crowding, type of accessibility to transit. And something like the Social Vulnerability Index can be overlaid with coronavirus data to give you some sense of how these things line up and where additional efforts might be needed in order to protect populations. And that kind of work is still to be done and is very important.
I want to get a final thought from both of you. And I want to reference something you wrote, Dr. Vesser, in a piece. And I'm sorry, I'm not sure if it was the Washington Post or the New York Times, but eloquently stated, failures of public policy and imagination have been stalking us for years. Some people are saying that big changes will follow what we're going through now. One example is that after World War II, the Department of Defense was created. Do you see this as a game changer? Is this something that is going to create those kind of significant structural and societal changes? And I want to give you the final word, Dr. Vesser. So Alex, let me get your thoughts on that, and then we'll turn back to Dr. Vesser.
Yeah, so I think that it's a tough question because while I want there to be a very strong...
I know speculation isn't what the Wilson Center trademarks itself in either, so I realize that, but
right,
it is
so
a
I'm
question
gonna answer...
that is on people's minds. You can hedge.
I'll answer your question and it'll have a little caveat in the sense that while I do think that this would be a time where Americans would take this threat more seriously and that would inspire larger government action, potentially consolidating different powers, I do think that within our current structure of the US, both geographically and the partisan divide, there's going to be a natural split in narratives in how Americans view what has happened here. And I know that might be hard to imagine now, but I fear that it might happen in the future. So whatever action, I'm not sure how proportional it's actually going to be. And that's speculation. So I hope that we come out of this stronger.
Dr. Vesser, you've been in this fight pre-pandemic. And you listed for us a number of things earlier that are the types of changes you think would be most useful. Are you hopeful that this could actually have a silver lining and those types of changes might occur as a result?
Well, you know, I hope that we see bipartisan support ongoing for public health and the need for preparedness. When I was working in the area of emergency preparedness and response, it was a bipartisan effort. There was value seen by people in blue states and red states and the people who represented them. And I would like to see us get back to that. On the bigger scale, I'm optimistic that this could have some real benefits in terms of getting people to really agree that health is about more than just having access to healthcare. It's about what takes place in our communities and where we work and where our kids go to school. And that there's more of a national sense that in America, everyone should have that opportunity for health, that everyone should be paid a living wage so that they can take care of their families and save a little money so that when crises come, they can be safe, that everyone has access to healthcare and a doctor so that when they're sick, they can be cared for. That people have access to communities with safe homes, and if they're sick or their relatives are sick, they can stay home and take care of them. These are things that I think we all believe are important. Whether we can see that there's more of a role for government to move forward on those policies, and we can come together a little bit more than we are now, I'm hopeful, I'm optimistic, and that's what we're working towards at the foundation.
Well, thank you for your ongoing efforts, and thank you for joining us today. Hope you enjoyed it and that you'll join us again sometime, perhaps, because as you said, this is not over anytime soon.
Thanks so much for having me. This is a really enjoyable conversation.
To our viewers, I want to thank you for joining us as well and hope you'll join us again soon. Until then, on behalf of Alex Long and all of us at the Woodrow Wilson Center, I'm John Molesky. Thanks for joining us.